Hello, students. This is Plants and Animals of Southern California, and today I am with Dr. Jim Hogue, who, among other things, is an expert in aquatic entomology. Welcome.
Thank you, Paul.
So we're going to run through a bunch of slides here. This first one is of a dragonfly larva, and you can see sticking out of its mouth there is this thing that it uses to grab its prey with. So this is a predator. This one has two different animals on it. And can you tell us about how to tell dragonfly larvae from damselfly larvae?
Well, again, both of these are in the order Odonata. The specimen on the bottom is the larva of a dragonfly, and the specimen on the top is a larva of a damselfly. And as Paul mentioned, you can see the extensible labrum that comes off the head that they use for catching their prey. But they're fairly easy to tell apart. Notice on the damselfly there are some leaf-like projections at the end of the abdomen. Those are their gills that they use to get oxygen from the water.
The dragonfly, they're like pump water in and out of their rectum.
Right, they have gills also, except they're turned inside out and they're held inside their body at the end of the abdomen.
And I think a dragonfly larva is usually more robust.
Yeah, like if you just their overall body, the damselflies tend to be more delicate looking, longer, thinner, and just kind of delicate, where the dragonflies tend to be more husky and stout.
Mm. Okay, so that's a predatory order. Now we're moving on to the Plecoptera, the stoneflies. And I guess stoneflies have a variety of different trophic roles, right?
Yes.
And this one, we found that with a lot of leaves, and supposedly these are shredders. They shred up leaves. This is Tanyonema. Is that right?
Sure, Tanyonema. That's one of the ones in some of your samples tend to be very common stoneflies.
And these stoneflies, they have two little tails coming off of their abdomen.
Right, so at first glance, it looks a little bit like one of those damselfly nymphs. And you go, well, how do you tell them apart? Their body is kind of the same shape, but notice two things. On one, this has very prominent antennae coming out of the head, and then the stoneflies have two of those long tail-like structures called cerci coming out of the back of the abdomen. The dragonflies and damselflies, they don't have either of those things.
Yeah. Okay, here's another plecopteran.
Again, notice the big antennae. Notice the two tails coming off, the cerci coming off the back. Also, as is true of the dragonflies and damselflies that are in complete metamorphosis, the way that they develop, you can see on these the wing pads where their wings are developing inside their bodies.
Yeah, and I don't know if it's always true, but at least a lot of the ones we come into contact with commonly, the stoneflies, you can see the three parts of the thorax pretty well, and they're kind of, you know, quasi-equal. And that's a bit different than the next order. Also, there's no gills on the abdomens of the stoneflies, the Plecoptera. If there's going to be any gills, they're kind of around the base of the legs.
Right, they'll be on the thorax, sometimes at the very tip of the abdomen, but not leaf-like gills along the sides of the abdominal segments, as you'll see in the next picture.
Okay, so we've been getting to this already. This is the order of mayflies, the Ephemeroptera, and this is Betis, which is super common, and a collector-gatherer. And you can see the wings there, but it looks almost like there's only just two wings.
Right, because in the mayflies, they have four wings, like other insects, except the first pair are very well-developed and strong, and that's really what they do their flying with. And when you can see the hind wings, they're very small and reduced. And so as they're developing here, you can see that's the thing different between that and the stoneflies. Here you see one pair of wing pads developing, and we saw two clearly in the stoneflies.
And it you know, kind of looks like the rear two thoracic segments are, you know, kind of fused together so much you would mistake them as one. Mm-hmm. Also, you can see those gills along the edge of the abdomen, a whole bunch of little leaf-like gills along the edge of the abdomen, which you don't always find in mayflies. But if you find them, you know, that's a good clue that it's a mayfly.
And notice there are cerci on the mayflies also, except they have three. Now, sometimes It looks like they only have two.
Now I'm going to advance the slide.
Yeah, because the central one is very small and reduced. Also notice, where are the antennae?
They're little things that are folding back.
They're there.
They're kind of narrow.
But in the stoneflies, they were very prominent. Mm-hmm. Okay, and so this one here, Epiorus, it's very dorsal, ventrally flattened, you know, flattened from top to bottom, and you can see the big flap-like gills on the sides of the abdomen. A very different creature than the stoneflies.
Yeah, we found this in fairly rapid moving water as compared to the betas.
Right. So if you take a look at the betas, it's more streamlined.
Like pools.
It actually can get up and swim through the water column. They're pretty good swimmers. This is more adapted to getting down to the boundary layer or getting very close to the surface of rocks or in between rocks. It's built differently.
All right, moving right along. Here's Trichorothotes, another ephemeropteran. And you can really see the three cerci there, the three tails on this one.
Right. If you see three cerci, mayfly. And this one's interesting because the gills on abdominal segment 2 are huge and triangular, and that's the only one we have around here that looks like that.
All right. Okay, so that was the mayflies. Now we're moving on to the caddisflies, and here's a couple caddisflies. So the top one there is Lepidostoma, and we often find tons of ones that look like this. Some of them are not Lepidostomum, but they're very close. And a lot of caddisflies, but not all of them, have these casings. So see the Lepidostomum, it's made a casing out of sand grains.
Right, so this whole order is famous for making these cases that they carry around with them. They sew things together, bits of sand or sticks or leaves, using silk. But as is true with lots of things, there are lots of exceptions. So not all caddisflies make cases. And you can
see
that
Rheacophila there, a predatory one.
Right, it's a free living predator, doesn't spend any time in a case, doesn't make a case, it just crawls around looking for other things to eat. Again, to tell these from the groups that we talked about before, if these have gills, they're finger-like projections on the body, not flap-like gills. Also look at the antennae. These have antennae, but you have to have a microscope to see it. They're extremely small.
And then the tail is going to be important because that's going to tell us, apart from some other stuff we'll see later on, often they have a couple little hooks on the tail rather than having, you know, something that just sticks out.
Right. So they have six well-developed legs, and then they have these hooks in the back that they use for holding onto the substrate or holding onto the inside of their case. And you can see this in all of these caddisflies here in these pictures.
Okay, here's another Trichopteran. This is Hydropsyche. We find tons of these kind of downstream pretty far where everything's been churned up a lot, and they're filtering out the little teeny particles. And they're kind of wrapped into a circle.
Yeah, these have a retreat that they live in. They're not free living, and they don't build a sleeping bag-like case that they carry all over with them. They build a silken retreat that they live in, and attached to that retreat is a big net that they orient so that small organic pieces of organic matter that are flowing down the stream get caught in this net, and then they periodically go out there and pick off the good stuff off of their net. And this one's interesting. If you look at the abdomen, it's very furry looking. These are these finger-like gills that we were talking about earlier that are all over the abdomen, and that's what they use to get oxygen from the
So in
water.
That retreat, then there's probably a bit of a problem getting oxygen.
Right. And this one, also notice that there's big plates on the top of each of the thoracic segments and a very large darkened sclerotized head. This group of caddisflies is very easy to recognize.
Okay, this is not a particularly common one, but it's kind of a cool one. It's compressed side to side, and it makes these little purse cases, and we don't find very many of them.
Hydroptera. These are also pretty small. Like the hydropsychids, these have three, the top of each of their thoracic segments is covered by a big sclerotized plate. As Paul mentioned, these live in little cases that aren't shown here that are little silken purses that they live in and carry with them. And these feed on plants. They'll eat diatoms and also pierce into submerged aquatic vegetation.
Okay, so that's the Trichoptera. And those last three orders, the Plecoptera, Ephemeroptera, and Trichoptera, I think of those as, you know, seriously aquatic things.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if there's anything that's not, any cases that don't have aquatic larvae. But then the next order here, this is the Coleoptera, the beetles. And, of course, there's tons and tons and tons of beetles that are not aquatic at all.
Right. Most of them are not aquatic, but since they're such a diverse group, it's not surprising that some of them have also have aquatic stages. Some beetles live in water as larvae and not as adults. Some live in the water as adults, not larvae, and others live in the water as adults and larvae.
So this is in the Diticidae, and that's an example.
It's
always in the water.
Right. They can come out and fly around, and that's what how they disperse. But you typically find them in water, and they live underwater.
And the adults, anyway, are predators.
Yes, and the larvae are too in that family.
Okay. And so let's see. Here's some Diticid larvae. The top one there is on the side, and you can't see the tail all that well. But, you know, like, you might mistake this for a caddisfly if you weren't careful. And looking at that tail, you can't see those hooks.
Right. No hooks. They have fairly decent-sized antennae, which you wouldn't see on the caddisflies. And these aren't going to have gills on the abdomen like the caddisflies would.
Yeah, the abdomen is sclerotized much more than a caddisfly normally.
Right, and when you get a chance to look at these under the microscope, go ahead and look at the mandibles. They're kind of scary-looking things, and you kind of see that they would be modified for preying on other aquatic invertebrates.
Okay, these ones are really charming. I love them. They're called water pennies.
That's in the genus Eubryanax in the family Cephenidae, and they're called water pennies because they live in the water. And if you have some imagination, they look a little bit about like pennies because they're so flat. When you tip it over and look underneath, you really do see the beetle larva there. You see its legs. It has gills down there on its abdomen. Once you've seen a water penny, you're not going to
mistake it for anything else.
That's it.
Okay, so that was the order Coleoptera, or the beetles. And then now we're going to go on to the true flies, the Diptera. And all these other things, you know, I could kind of characterize, but true flies, you just got to learn a whole bunch of different types and remember they're all true flies. So probably the ones that are the most common that we see are these chironomid midges. The chironomidae are kind of difficult to tell apart, but there are three subfamilies that we can pay attention to. So this one is the orthocladinae, and maybe we see the most of these guys. These are usually collector gatherers. And they're kind of worm-like. You know, they look like a maggot. And if you look at their front legs, it's not like, you know, there's three pairs of well-developed legs.
That's right. They don't have any real legs there. They have a pair of prolegs up there by the head that has a little knob of hooks on there. And then they have some legs at the leg-like structures at the opposite end of the body with hooks on them. But notice they have a very well sclerotized and defined head with some fairly short antennae. But other than that, they really don't have many projections on them.
Okay, so here's the next subfamily. So we're still in the Chironomidae, but this is the Tanypodinae of the Chironomidae. And we usually characterize these as predators, although I guess they don't start out being predators. But you can see the prolegs there pretty well.
Right. These tend to all have fairly elongate heads. If you notice, when you look back at the previous slide, it was not too much longer than wide. These are sometimes a few to two or three times longer than wide. And again, once you see enough of them and have somebody tell you what they are, you'll start to get a feel for what the Tanypodinae look like, what the Orthocladinae look like, and then the next subfamily is the Chironomidae, and they have their own look about them also. Some of these are interesting, and like caddisflies, they build and live in cases. And this one here, Rio Tanytarsus, does just that. It makes a little case out of silk and detritus, and it builds.
But it doesn't move the case around. The case is fixed to the.
It's
sessile. Okay, so we're still in the true flies, but now we're moving on to a different part of the true flies. This is Caloperiphus, and that's characterized as a collector-gatherer. And if you look at the rear end of it, it's got a little star of unwettable hairs there. I think that they often hang from the surface and from those hairs. Okay, so this is a crane fly. This is a different part of the true flies, and I guess it has a sclerotized head, but you can't see it.
Right. It has. It's in some of them they're almost completely sclerotized. In others, it's mostly some long sclerotized rods and attached mandibles. But in this group of flies, that head is all normally retracted with inside the thorax, and you don't see it. These turn into, to some of us, they're fairly familiar, very long, gangly-legged flies.
Yeah, that, like huge mosquitoes.
Yes.
Okay, this is one that we, you know, absolutely must know. This is a black fly larvae. And the black fly larvae, they are in the fast-flowing water, the riffles. So they make a little pad of silk. And then they hold on to that pad of silk. So the silk is glued to the rock, and they hold on to the silk pad. And then on their head, they have these strange structures. I don't know exactly what they are, but they open them up and filter out the food.
Right. So one way to recognize these is they kind of look like bowling pins. And the fat end is the end of the abdomen that has that ring of little hooks that Paul mentioned that they hang on to the silk with. Then at the other end, they have a very fairly sclerotized head, and then those structures that are coming out, they're called cephalic fans, and they have long finger-like projections with lots of bristles on them, and they hold those up into the water current and filter out particles of organic matter that are flowing in the current. So these are filter feeders.
All right, so we've gone through some of the really big orders of insects that are in streams. We started out with the Odonata, the dragonflies and damselflies, and then we went to the Plecoptera, the stoneflies, and then the Ephemeroptera, the mayflies, and those two are kind of easily confused with one another. Then we went to the Trichoptera, the caddisflies, and then since then we've done Coleoptera and Diptera, which are also important components of streams. We'll just end here with one other order that we almost never find in streams, and that's the Lepidoptera, the order of moths and butterflies.
This one's called Petrophila, and this is really it's a real moth, but the caterpillar lives underwater. And like most caterpillars, they're herbivorous, they eat plant matter, but this one eats plant matter that's algae that's growing on rocks. And these use their own silk that they produce to make a little silken retreat on rocks. In some places, they can be very common, and sometimes almost every rock has one of these pyralid moth larvae on it. These also have six well-defined legs. In the picture, you can see them. You can just see them up there and coming off of the thoracic segments. And then they have some prolegs. Again, this is a moth caterpillar. It really does look like a caterpillar that you would find in a terrestrial situation living on plants, but it lives underwater.
Okay, well, that's really all that we have to say about that.
All right.
Thanks a lot.
Sure. Have fun splashing.